as this combined group of worshipers, I want as they, the musicians, are gonna give a beautiful, resounding introduction that's gonna set the pace for awesome. And they can start, yes. And then as this wonderful group of happy and hilarious worshipers began to resound with the words to a song that could only apply to the almighty, matchless Lamb of God. Praise God. Awesome. Is this the move?
Somebody lift your hands as we celebrate the greatness of our God. And it's great and greatly to be praised. There's a worship song. From the rain. Come on, our God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Thank you, Jesus. And I'm broken. Forever He will reign. Come on, if you believe it, say, our God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
He can move mountains. Keep me in the valley. Hide me from the rain. Our God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
He'll speak when I'm broken.
Strength
when I'm weak. Forever He will reign. Come on, if you believe it, raise your voice and say it. Come on, if you believe it, say it.
Awesome.
Raise your voice. If you believe it, raise your voice and sing. Come on, lift your voice and say it. If you believe it, testify.
Say,
Somebody ought to praise His holy name. Somebody ought to celebrate our awesome God. Hallelujah! 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I am working in ways that my people cannot imagine. I am working in manners that you cannot fathom. I am doing a work on the behalf of my people that if you told somebody about it, they would not believe it. Oh, trust me, trust me, trust me, trust me. You must be a people of trust. You must be a people of reliance. You must be a people of dependence. I don't have to show you. I don't have to tell you. But you just walk going straight ahead and watch and see. Oh, what I do on the behalf of my people, because I am pleased, I am pleased, I am pleased. It is faith. Faith is the only thing that pleases me. And you show your faith by your obedience. Oh, do what I say do. Trust, trust. Trust when I say trust. Walk, walk, walk in a continual state of total reliance, knowing of a surety that I am the Lord your God, and I will work. I have worked, and who will let? Who will hinder? None. None, 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 none. Oh, I am in a state. Ever since I broke in on a telephone call, ever since the Lord woke me up at 4:45 And he shared some very, very deep things with me concerning our advancing move. And then at 20 after 5, he said, look at the clock. And I looked at the clock and he said, break in on this telephone conversation. He said, because my people have heard my voice and my people are speaking a word of direction that I am requiring of you from this moment forward. The Lord told me to tell each and every one of you, you cannot take a lackadaisical attitude into the place where I am taking you. God told me to tell each and every one of you, pack up your bags of dissatisfaction. Pack up your bags of unbelief. Pack up your bags of lack of confidence. Pack up your bags of fear of advancement and put them in the fire so that I may consume them and suit yourself up and get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Drive and go forward because all is well. Praise God. Give him the glory. All is well. All is well. All is well. All is well. When Gideon was listening to the voice of the Lord, and God told the angel to go to a man who it looked like in the natural was a wimp, but because of the powerful word from God and the word of God, the angel spoke 4 words into the spirit man of Gideon, and he said, mighty man of valor. That word had such a dynamic effect on Gideon's spirit man until God turned him inside out and brought forth the mighty man of valor. Listen, the wimp Gideon thought he needed 10,000 men. But God told Gideon, he said, you got too many. Actually, he started out with 32,000 and God whittled them down to 10,000. And Gideon thought he had done something. Hey, I can see Gideon with his little walk and God say, hey, Gideon, you got too many. So God told him how to narrow it down. And you know what he said? He didn't say those that are crippled. The cripple could go. He didn't say those that are blind. The blind could have went. He didn't say those that are stupid, they could have went. But he said there is only one way to separate those that cannot go, those that are fearful, and those that are unbelieving. Send them back home. To Gideon's amazement, he thought maybe 1,000 or 2 would have went back home. But all of a sudden, Gideon looked up, and the whole church, the whole army started walking off. And when Gideon got out his calculator, he wound up having to throw it away, because Gideon looked and it wasn't nothing but 300 men left. Anointed word is about to advance. Anointed word is about to move forward and higher. Hey, everyone that belongs in the 300, jump up and say, that's me, and I'm ready, I'm ready, I'm ready. That means even if you are blind, crippled, and crazy, you can still go. Just no fearful and no unbelieving can go. Say, I'm going, and I'm ready, and I don't care how it looks, how it sounds. I'm in faith, and I got what it takes to please God. I got my marching shoes. They are on my feet. I'm buckling up, and I'm ready. Come on, anointed word. Let's go. Give me some marching music. Hey, come on, faster. Come on, more, more. There you go. Come on. Listen. God said a new thing. Is he getting ready to do? God said a great thing. Is he gonna do with you? I'm looking for the greatness. I'm looking for advancement. And I'm ready. And I'm ready. Lord, have your way with anointed word. Do the work you want to do. I love you, and I'm excited with what you're doing with us. Praise God. On your birthday, we're loving you for what you are doing with us. Hallelujah. 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 Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Now listen, while you are in the midst of this happy hilarity, get your offering in your hand. Get your offering in your hand. Write your check. Write it out. And when you come up, bring a shout of your expectation from God. He is ready to bless you. fire. He is ready to open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing you wanna have room to rest in. How many are ready? How many are ready? How many want it? How many got to have the blessing of God? He said, do it my way. He said, do it my way. And I will show you. I'll bless your basket. I'll bless your store. And everything you put your hands to will be blessed. Stand up right now. Lift your money. Lift your envelope. Say, Lord, bless my offering. Say, Lord, multiply my offering. Lord, bring my harvest. Speedily. Speedily. I expect it. I expect it. I know that you have done it. I love you, Lord, with all my heart. And I know you will do it, 'cause you said, praise God.
Kingdom and needs of your people.
glad you're in the house of the Lord today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm so glad I came out to praise God today. And I'm so glad for what God is doing in my life. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. As we continue to reverence his presence, we're going to hear from the minstrels. Hallelujah. The majestic minstrel. Hallelujah. Why don't you guys go ahead and bless God, ladies? Bless God. Hallelujah.
Thank you. but what I did see, I thoroughly enjoyed. And I thank God for the young people. Amen. Amen and amen. Happy birthday to all that are born in the month of December. So 12 is complete. And we've been here for 12 years. God is doing something great, and I'm just excited about it. Amen, amen, and amen. On our week of a glance, we have from the pastor's desk. This is part two. On last week, we had part one. And all those who did not read it, go home and read it, and then include part two. What is commitment, and just how valuable is it? Amen. I'm quite sure that God planted this in the pastor. So if he planted it in our pastor, amen. Concert tribute to Inez and Miguel of the Famous Caravan, Thursday, December 7th, 2012. Bishop Byron Brazier is the pastor of Apostolic Church of God, 63rd and Dorchester in Chicago, Illinois, from 7 p.m. Amen. Yes, she passed, and actually, celebration, Friday, December 28th, the pre-wake breakfast is at 9:45 to 11 a.m., and the wake is from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. The funeral is from, celebration is from 11 a.m. to 12 a.m. Amen. And if you would like there at the table, amen. All who can attend, please do. Amen. Notice of condolences in the passing of William H. Harris of Ontario, California, brother of Mother Virginia Pierce, uncle of Gina Pierce. His transition the morning of Thursday, December 20th. From hospice care, he was saved. Amen. Amen. The memorial service is at Lifeway Church, and this is in California. You can also pick up this for souvenir. Be with our mother. Amen. Amen. All our first. Do we have any first? Amen. Again.
Hallelujah. Everyone standing, please. Hallelujah. We thank God for the word of God this morning coming from our pastor. We thank God that our hearts are prepared to receive what he has given her and to walk therein. Receive our pastor, Dr. Jacqueline Anderson.
I am so excited. I'm not excited about the other birthdays in December. I'll talk to you next week. But today, I am in a state of happy hilarity over the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh God Almighty, Lord God, we are so thankful. So many people in the earth don't have a clue. And Lord, so many people, they really don't believe that you, Lord Jesus, were born on that this particular juncture. And matter of fact, there are some things that the people need to realize and know. But Lord, the thing that is a blessing is not the day that you were born, not the month that you were born, but the fact that you were born. Holy Spirit, we thank you so very much for the awesome way that you worked to get the Lord Jesus here in the earth. And Lord God, as we talk about some issues that are so vitally, vitally important, so that the people will know beyond a shadow of a doubt that it is absolutely true that Jesus was born of a virgin. Lord God, help your people to be able to understand how the living word is what brought Jesus Christ here on the scene. Touch the hearts of each and everyone that's here in the house. And Lord God, there are so many people that are depressed. They are fearful during this time of the year because many of them don't have loved ones, don't have friends, don't have people that they can even share during this wonderful season. And I'm asking right now that you break depression off of them. I bind the spirit of fear and the spirit of depression. And Lord God, let your people care enough to spread some cheer to their neighbors, to the people down the block, to someone in a nursing home, to someone in a senior building that has nobody. And Lord God, I'm asking that you bless all of the children that are in the children's hospital, those that are in St. Jude's, Lord, that are suffering from cancer. Lord God, the families of all of those beautiful children who were cut down. They didn't even get the chance to reach the prime of their lives. But Lord, they were cut down. They were massacred. And these people, they don't feel joy to the world like we are feeling on today. And I'm asking, Lord, release your anointing. Speak to the hearts of people that are near to that state, near to that town. Send people to sing Christmas carols. Send people to give, to minister love. Send people to let the people know that we are praying over your lives. Lord, this grief is far beyond the realm of many of their imaginations. And right now, many of them are feeling that I will never get over this. And Lord God, I'm asking that you cause them to realize and know that when little children, when their lives are cut off, Lord, there's a special way that you work with little children. And I thank you, Lord, that little children don't have to be afraid of hell, but Lord, they can look forward to being in your presence. Lord God, bless the people there that are under Hurricane Sandy's terrible effects. We act as though it is over with. And Lord, for some of the people, oh, they are still without heat, still without lights, still have not been able to go home. And Lord, many of us slept in our own warm beds on last night. I'm asking that you intervene. It is not in the hands of the government. It is not in the hands of FEMA. But Lord, it is in your hands, and we place it in your hands. Do a mighty manifested work in the name of Jesus. We ask it, and we thank you. Amen. You can be seated. Praise God. As we go into the word on today, we're going to hit some very familiar scriptures, but I believe that the Lord is going to do something with you, with these scriptures on today. I want to tell everybody here a very, very Merry Christmas. Please, please don't say Happy Holidays. Not to Pastor Jackie. I am not intimidated by what is politically correct. Political correctness usually means the kingdom of God uncorrectness. So let us be God correct and realize that the only reason for this season is that Jesus Christ was born. I give God glory, honor, and praise. And I thank the Lord so very, very much for his awesome word. Many of you really have not yet realized the value of God's awesome word. And I want to tell each and every one of you, if it were not for the word of God, Jesus would never have been able to be in Mary's womb. If it were not for the word of God, there would have been no virgin birth. If it were not for the word of God, all of the scriptures that we have found, the prophetic scriptures, they would have been missing in the Bible because there would have been no need for those scriptures. But on today, we're going to go over with why it took the word of God to bring Jesus on the scene. Okay. Oh, you can clap. It's okay. Listen, one thing that most of you don't realize is that when we talk about the word of God, it is something about the word of God that is so incredible, because the word of God literally expresses the absolute, the eternal, and the ultimate being of the Lord Jesus Christ. Many of you, when you read the Bible, you don't realize that everything that is here in the Bible, from Genesis 1 and 1 all the way through to the very last verse in the book of Revelation, it is all about Jesus Christ, the historical, the prophetic, the law. All of that is pointing toward Jesus Christ. And I want you to turn to a very familiar scripture, because many of you often hear me, it seems as though in at least 25 or 30% of the sermons that I preach, I find this scripture in that sermon, because this particular scripture explains everything about why the word of God. Let's turn in the word. Every minister, deacons, whoever else respects the word of God, I want each of you turn to the book of Hebrews 4:12. Y'all thought it was going to be something different. Okay. Everybody, please stand. Those that respect the word of God. And it says, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. You can be seated. When God had the writer, when the Holy Spirit revealed this book of Hebrews to the writer, there was so much theological excellence in this book of Hebrews. And as I studied deeper, looking into the word, it expresses the absolute. Absolute means that there is nothing outside of God's word. There is nothing around God's word that was not brought about as a result of the word of God being spoken. There are so many people that they don't realize that the reason God gave us the Bible, it is not for us to sit and read the Bible and silently think about what the word of God says, but in order for a word to be a word, it has to be spoken. I'm going to say that again so that I can wake up the people that are dozing. In order for the word to be a word, it must be spoken. When letters are put together on a page, they say absolutely nothing. There are thousands of words in the Bible, but hold your Bible up, Minister Brown. Shake your Bible. Turn it over. Turn it inside out. How many of you heard what it said? Not nobody. You didn't hear it. Now read that fourth chapter, verse 12. Just read the first five words. Okay. Now, how many of you heard words? And guess what? Until those words got uttered, the word of God was not. Until those words were uttered, the word of God was not. So you've got to realize and know that there must have been an awful lot of talk going on in the heavenly realm, because in St. John 1:1, we find that the word of God says what? In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. So now, knowing that, and then looking at verse 12, it says that the word of God is what? And that word quick means life producing. So in the beginning was the life producing word of God. And the life producing word of God was with God, and the life-producing word of God was God. That means without the word of God, you have no God. You have no relationship with God. God cannot exist in your heart except that you have his word in your heart. That's why most people cannot figure out how it is that the Bible says that it is not of works, lest any man should boast. And oftentimes people come up to me and they say, what good is it to do good works if works can't save you? It's okay to do good works to make you feel good, but it cannot save you, because doing is not uttering. And so I don't care how much do that you do, do never utters. How many of you are getting it? Do cannot utter. Do just makes movements. Do just puts stuff together and takes it apart. But in your do, there is never any life. That's why you cannot, I don't care how much work that you think you are doing for the kingdom of God, you cannot produce anything for God in the kingdom with works, because works, all they do is manifest that you had energy, expended energy, and produced an action. But you cannot get saved. You cannot get healed. You cannot get delivered. You cannot advance. You cannot do anything in the earth that brings forth life without the use of words. God has made this very, very clear. And to go back, it says that words, they are theological phrases that express. It means that they come out and they make sounds, speech sounds. And when the speech sounds come up forth, they cause things to occur. Now, if we look in the Bible, there was a terrible cataclysmic event that occurred called the Contable. I don't talk about this often, but the Contable caused the earth to become without form and void. The Contable caused the earth to have no form, no shape, no order to it at all. Now, if the Contable was able to do that, that means in the beginning, the earth must have had form and not been void, not been empty. The earth had all kinds of life and life capabilities. But as a result of the devil having to be expelled from heaven, as a result, that was so cataclysmic until it caused a terrible shakeup in the whole atmosphere, not just the earth. The whole atmosphere was shaken up. All of the planets, all of the whole solar system was all shaken up. Why do you think when they study the planets, they find big craters, big holes in the different planets, in the moons, in the suns, and they make no sense whatsoever? The God of order could never produce any garbage like that. The God of order produced an orderly in the beginning when he created the heavens and the earth. They were beautiful. They were orderly. they were hooked up in sync, and there was nothing ugly, out of order, chaotic at all about it. But when Satan rebelled and he thought that he had the right to put himself on an equal footing with God, God had to expel him out of heaven right away. And you got to realize Satan was a very powerful archangel. But knowing that he was an angel, you got to know that he was a created being. And it's no way that the thing created can say to the creator, how can you do this? Why? Or I want to be like you. It's just the same as if Diana Klein made a dress, and the dress, as she went to take it off the hanger and put it on, the dress ran from her and say, no, Diana, you ain't wearing me today. Matter of fact, I'm going over and I'm going to robe Minister Mary Brown, because I don't want to be with you. Come on. Look, it sounds hilarious, but it is the exact same way. Satan had no capability of being anything like God. Matter of fact, because God made him the full pattern, then when the angels kicked him out, it caused such a cataclysmic occurrence until it messed up the earth. It gave the earth cavities all over itself, and it messed up the solar system. And so it stayed in that manner for a little while until God opened up his mouth. If God had never opened his mouth after that terrible occurrence happened, the earth would still be without form and void, and darkness would still be covering the earth. And if you don't believe it, turn to Genesis 1:2-3, and it says, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness. I think y'all know where Genesis is, don't you? Okay, all right. And I heard some pages flipping. And so darkness was upon the face of the deep. And then it says, read, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water. And what happened next? Holy Spirit was waiting for God to utter words, because even before the foundation of the world, God had set up laws in the universe. Listen, these are not just earth laws. These are universe laws. And in God's awesome creation called the universe, there had to be words spoken in order for any action. Did you hear what I say? In order for how many? I don't hear you. What does that mean? If there's not any, then how many actions are there? None. Oh, that thought. So, the Bible says that the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Holy Spirit, who is the Spirit of the Father and the Spirit of the Son, Holy Spirit knew that no work, no action, no creation, nothing could be produced. That's why it says the Holy Spirit moved. But that doesn't mean that he was moving stuff like, I'm moving right now. No, he was brooding. He was hovering. Not like no bird. I'm just doing this to make you see, to give you a picture of how Holy Spirit was waiting. He wasn't twiddling his thumbs. He wasn't picking his fingernails. He wasn't picking his teeth. But he was waiting. And Holy Spirit say, it's not a thing that I can do until the word of God gets uttered out of his mouth. Because if he never speaks, then I can never produce anything. Because no thing in the universe can be produced without words, not actions, without words. So Holy Spirit was brooding over the face of the deep. I can imagine Holy Spirit was looking and saying, because he couldn't touch a thing. But when God, I imagine all of heaven stood up and at attention when they heard God say, because the very thought that God, the Father, the awesome originator, the source of every, you know what a source is? It is the origination point from which every action, every reaction, everything, everybody comes forth. And if the source doesn't put out what the source is responsible for putting out, nothing will ever happen. But the source, I don't know if he was standing or what, but all I know is that at the set time that God appointed, he and Holy Spirit got ready. And he said, let, so the whole universe released ability for production. Oh, please get this. When if God had just said, let, everything in the universe would have been released to go forth. But God was specific. He said, let there be light. Because if he hadn't gotten out, let there be light, there would have been all kinds of stuff happening, because God said, let. And the minute God said, let, Holy Spirit, see, God's word expresses absolute, eternal, and ultimate results. Meaning, when God opens his mouth and he says something, everything that God says steps out of nothingness and begins to be somethingness. You understand? And it keeps on going for eternity. So, as God said that, then please, God did not start the world formless and void. He did not. Everything that he said, he replenished. He refixed up. He repopulated. He reorganized. He means that God did over again that which once was but got messed up. And if God had never done it, it would have stayed without form and void. So then God made man in his own image. And remember, the Son was there in the heavenly realm with the Father, but it wasn't the Son's job to speak. Listen, y'all gotta understand, it wasn't the Son's job to speak, because the Son's job was to become that which was spoken. Oh my God. Oh, how many of you are getting it? The Son could not say a word. The Son, all he could do was implement the work that the Father spoke. And so that's the reason why, as the Son was there watching the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they had already had the major council meeting in glory. And so it was already decided that the Son was going to come and fix up the mess that the original man had made. But it wasn't gonna be by him talking. Only the source could do the talking. And so as the source talked to the Holy Spirit and the Son, and he said, listen, we're going to implement a process here in the earth. He said, because Son, you're going to have to go down through 42 generations in order to get in the earth. Why? Because God was getting ready to become a man. And how many of you know that the Almighty God could not come as a result of one sperm cell from some man, because it would have blown, it would have bust her body into, he would have probably had to have a half a race of people to take a little piece of himself in order, and then each piece would have had to run together and combine to become one man. But God is so awesome. God say, listen, you guys, he said, I am not gonna do it that way. He said, I got such an awesome method whereby Jesus, he said, Son, I'm gonna get you in, but you can't go until the time is right. And many of us think it's about the time. It is not about the time. It is about the combination of words that were spoken in the earth. So, because every word that was spoken in the earth, what God did, God spoke through the prophets. And so what words did the prophets get? The prophets were given God's words. The prophets could not speak man's words. They could not speak their words. But the words that the prophets spoke had to be God's words, because the, I'm going to give you a word again, the deic neo mai process does not work except it's God's words, because ain't a man in the earth that is powerful, it's smart enough to start a deic neo mai process. But that process came out of the heavenly realm for the purpose of getting God's Son here in the earth. This thing blows me away, because if you think about it, look at how God did. God started out. He couldn't let man start the process. God had to start the process. And that's why when man brought sin into the earth, as God began meeting out the curse, as God began letting male man and female man know the mess that they had created here in the earth, God said, look, he had already said, let us make man in our own image and after our own likeness. You know why? Because the person speaking God's words had to be a God man. A person speaking God's word had to be able to get words out of their mouth. It couldn't come out of their toe. It couldn't come out of their back. But because God uttered words out of his mouth, then his man that was made in his image and after his likeness had to have a mouth and had to utter words out of his mouth, because there would be no response to the word if it wasn't done God's way. Oh, God. Oh, y'all, is this too deep? Am I taking you too deep? I gotta carry you deeper. So, as God said, look, Satan, he said, you brought sin into the earth. And he said, I'm not gonna get it out. He said, I'm gonna use a seed of a wounded man in order to get your mess out of the earth. So as he said, the seed of the wounded man is gonna talk like I talk. He didn't tell Satan that, but that was the plan. See, the plan in the councils of glory is that man is going to have our ability to speak God's words. And the same thing that happens when God talks is the same thing that's going to happen when man talks. Oh, come on now, tell me. Am I by myself? This blew me away. Oh, God said, the seed of the woman is going to bust your head. Satan couldn't figure that out, because all the time that Satan was up in heaven with God, he never saw nothing like a man. Up in the heaven, there wasn't no men up in the heaven. So Satan knew that the only great, wonderful stuff happened was when God spoke. So he couldn't figure out how God was gonna make a God. Oh, God. He couldn't figure out. He said, can't nobody but God talk and make stuff happen. Oh, my God, I feel like I could fly. So Satan wasn't worried. He wasn't concerned as long as he didn't see God making no other God. But then he should have gotten shaken up when in the book of the Psalms, the book of the Psalms talked about what is man, that thou art mindful of him, or what is it, the son of man, that thou visitest him. And then the secret came out. But it was a hidden mystery because the psalmist say, you have made him a little lower than the angels, but you did something. You crowned this man with glory and honor, and then you took him and you set him over the works of your hand. That's why, while Jesus was here, do you know they complained about Jesus talking about the Father? God was his Father. And he said, did not I say that you are? Come on, say it. Theological gibberish makes you scared to talk like God say you are. If we can take God's word and put God's word in our mouth and speak God's word aloud, and if you notice, everything I'm saying is about God. So if God can make us, and if God can make us talk, and if God could give us his word, and if God could explain his word, and if God could reveal his word, and if God could make our mouth, and if God could help us talk, and if God could put his word in our mouth, what do you think gonna happen? God's stuff is going to occur. I picked the wrong day to preach this. He gives me so much, and I ask him, I say, why you do that to me? He say, go preach it to yourself. He said, because I'm going to give you joy as you draw waters out of the well of salvation. So, as God explained to me, he said, you know, baby, he said, it's really very simple. Yeah, he calls me baby. I'm his baby. He said, it is so simple that a fool couldn't err, but it's so complicated because my people become fools when they won't learn what my word has to say, and therefore spiritual blindness overtakes my people and they are unable to see. Oh, God say, he say, I started the Deikneomai process when I said that the seed of the wounded man is going to bruise the head of the serpent. So I wish I had a long red rope. So as the seed began to be sprinkled in the earth by way of the Deikneomai process, the line started moving down from the first generation down through the second generation, down through the third generation, progressing on through the 10th generation. And as the Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews, he says, look at Hebrews 1:1. It says very clearly in the book of Hebrews 1:1, God, who at sundry times and in divers manners did what? Stop. God at different times and in different manners, what did he do? Spoke. That's all that was necessary So he spoke in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, by the time that he got through to Isaiah. And Isaiah must have been going on the 18th or more generations. And so Isaiah began to speak the word of God. Isaiah did not get this off of the top of his head. Isaiah did not read T.D. Jakes books. Isaiah did not go to the Library of Congress and find out what George Washington had to say. But Isaiah sat before God. And Isaiah, as he sat before God, oh, after Uzziah died, Isaiah's ears got cleaned out. And so one day, as he was talking to God, and God said, hey, he said, look, there's going to come forth 11 and 1. There's going to come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch is going to grow out of his roots. And God said, you know what's going to happen? He said, Spirit of the Lord is going to rest upon this rod. And he said, look, as the Spirit of the Lord rests upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. When God said it, God was saying it for information. But when Isaiah said it, Isaiah was saying it as a result of revelation. And God said that it is by revelation that I make known unto you the mysteries of the kingdom of God. So as he finished off telling him about verse 5, righteousness is going to be the girdle of his loins. You ain't got to go to Lane Bryant. You ain't got to go to the feel-good store. He said, because righteousness, it's going to be the girdle of his loins. So the Dignaomai process, Isaiah got out there and he began to preach. And he said, a rod is going to come forth. And the line, somebody give me some. And the line began to move. Give me one of those cloths. And the line began to move. So the Dignaomai process started operating again. And so he said, a rod is going to come forth. And there he went on, and more word began to come forth on the scene, because it was the word of God coming out of the mouth of a man of God who had the same capability of speaking God's word and causing things to be produced. I gotta keep my Dignaomai process. So as God kept speaking, and the Bible says, at different times and in many different ways, God, he said, spoke in times past unto the fathers by the prophets. So finally Malachi got a hold to the word of God. And as Holy Spirit began to speak to Malachi, and Malachi got the revelation that the Son of Righteousness was going to arise with healing in his wings. So the Dignaomai process began to move on. And Malachi looked at the timer and he said, which generation have this covered? Then Galatians 4:4. At the set time, turn to Galatians 4:4. What did it say? Something happened. about the fullness of time. And at the fullness of time, the diagnosis process stopped. Because there was a little virgin girl. And that little virgin girl had heard about her cousin that was pregnant. And she had been taught the word of God. So she had known enough about the word of God until she knew that one day a virgin was gonna conceive in her womb. So when Gabriel got there to her, Gabriel came with the word from God. So Gabriel said, "Fear not." He said, "Because thou art highly favored among women." He said, "You have been selected." Watch this. He said, "You have been selected. And you're going to conceive in your womb." And he said that this child that's going to be born of you shall be the Son of God. And you're going to call his name Jesus. Now Mary had an egg warming on the wall of her uterus. But this couldn't have touched her. Except what happens with everybody that gets the word of God. In order for the word of God to produce, they've got to utter it. If Mary had said, no way. And I take the chance of me getting killed, of me getting stoned, of Joseph accusing me of being a fornicator. She could have done that. And it would have, they would have, this would have had to keep on going. But when Gabriel said what he said, the quick, powerful, sharp word of God began to hover over the top of Mary's head, because Holy Spirit knew that she was going to accept it. And so as the Holy Spirit was hovering, just like he was hovering over the face of the deep, he couldn't do nothing with Mary except that Mary said, so she said, "Be it unto me at thy word." I gotta quit. Listen, y'all. That's why I'm getting ready to launch a teaching class on my own. It ain't gonna be hooked up with the university, but I'm gonna launch a teaching class where the University of the Holy Ghost, God have taken me to the school of the Holy Ghost, and he told me whatever member, whatever visitor, whatever viewer would want to become a part, open up the doors wide and let them come in, because you're not gonna, I love T.D. Jakes, but I don't want him to teach me nothing. I want Holy Ghost to tell me everything that I want to know. So that second verse says, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. The impregnation of Mary became the Son of God's voice here in the earth. And there will never, ever, ever be another need for a voice, because the Son that was created was born impregnated in the womb of Mary was the final word that God would ever have to speak ever again. there is not coming along another one. They keep talking about a different Messiah. They lying. They keep talking about a Muslim Messiah. They lying. They keep talking about Confucius and Mohammed or whatever, whoever. There is never going to be another spoken word here in the earth except in the hearts of his people. He's gonna put his word in your heart and write them in your mind, and he's gonna be to you a father, and you are gonna be to him a son. And you're the one that's gonna say to your neighbor, you're the one that's gonna speak to the people, you're the voice that's gonna be heard here in the earth. Listen, television viewers, I can't help the way the Lord deals with me. He lets other people do shorthand, but he makes me do century hand. He gives me so much that I am never able to finish it. But let me say to you, Merry Christmas. Let me say to all of you, it ain't no happy holiday here. It is the holy day that we celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ. What about see? I dare you to keep on listening. I dare you to stay tuned to the rest of these telecasts. I dare you to hook up with WYCA 102.3 FM on your dial every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 5:30 a.m. Oh, God, it's going to take you so high in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to make you a master. Oh, God, I love you. And I'm going to ask every partner, every viewer, if anointed word has ever meant anything to you, I want to let you know that there's going to be a relocation and we're not going to be here that much longer. God is getting ready to do a great work with anointed word. And this building, it won't accommodate what God is going to do. We're going to have a healing room. We're going to have a teaching room. We're going to have an anointing room. We're going to have a room just for getting filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm asking if anointed word means anything to you. I'm asking you, starting now, would you up increase the donations that you send to the ministry? We're going to be in a temporary location for a while. But guess what? God has a building in store for us. And I'm asking each and every one of you, would you dig down deep in your pockets and help us to acquire what God has in store for anointed word. I praise God for you, every one of you, and I thank God in advance because I believe that you're gonna do it. $10 is not gonna get it. We need you to go in your wallets and write out some checks and ask Holy Ghost, what do I need to send to my television pastor? I love you so very much. Stay tuned. We have sent out correspondence already, and we want you to use the P.O. boxes from now on until we let you know more. And I love you. Pray for us. And we continue to pray over you. Praise God. Hallelujah. listen, I want to tell everybody there is nothing solid right at this moment. But for the first Sunday in January, we're going to meet at the Tinley Park Convention Center for, oh, come on now. Great things are on the horizon. I believe that God is going to send some people in that convention center, that he's going to have us to touch. Souls are going to get saved. Many of you, you don't even know it, but one of the main, and I'm not going to give her name, she met us by way of the victory breakfast, and she was going through something, and the Lord had me to pray over her. She is now saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. Listen, God say, in the hedges and the highways, get out there and compel men to come in. We're doing some evangelistic, some, oh, all kinds of missionary work, oh, benevolent work, and God is still blessing us more and more and more. Minister Brown, invite them to the Lord.